So this has really been an amazing morning. And I wanted to think of something to say that would really summarize the experience. And I was racking my brains. And fortunately, someone here in the audience saved me, because I was looking at the boards that are outside the theater. And somebody wrote on their card, where people are posting their experiences, simply, hashtag better than Tuesday class. So it's really great to join this discussion. And for my part, I would like to tell a story. Now, I'm a physicist, so I've been told that my idea of what makes an interesting story is a little bit unusual. So in the event that your mind should start to wander, I want to suggest a destination. Think about this. What is your favorite story, and why? The story I want to tell you is the story of the 2013 Nobel Prize in Physics, awarded to Peter Higgs and François Englert for their idea about where particles get mass from. Now, this is really a truly appropriate story for the theme of creating knowledge together, because as you heard, the confirmation of their idea came from two scientific collaborations, each with 3,000 scientists from around the world working together to try to understand this problem. The CMS experiment that I'm a part of and the ATLAS experiment at the Large Hadron Collider in Geneva, Switzerland. It's really been amazing to be a part of this discovery. Perhaps you saw the coverage in the news and you were wondering, what's the big deal? To understand that, you need to know the broader story. The goal of particle physics is to try to understand the fundamental building blocks that make up the world that we live in. In the 1960s and 1970s, we came up with a theory to do just that. This theory has now become known as the Standard Model. And you can see a diagram here that summarizes the basic elements of the Standard Model. So matter is composed of two types of particles, quarks and leptons. And those particles interact by means of four fundamental interactions or forces: the electromagnetic and gravitational forces with which you might be familiar, and the strong and the weak nuclear forces that really only have an effect at the scale of an atomic nucleus. Now, with this picture, we can understand not only everything that you can see in the world around you, but also such extreme and distant phenomena as what is happening at the center of a star burning deep in space, or what was going on in the early universe only moments after the Big Bang. It's truly a phenomenally successful theory whose predictions have been confirmed by careful experiments, in some cases to more than 10 decimal places. The problem really comes in when we start to try to consider particle masses. You see, the picture that I've given you here really only works if all the particles are massless. But we know that particles have mass. In fact, we know that the top quark is 60,000 times more massive than the up and the down quark. The big idea from Higgs and Englert and others was to figure out a way for particles to have mass without messing up the rest of the theory. And they did this by adding another particle, which we now call the Higgs boson, or as you may have heard in the popular media, the God particle. So it was the discovery of this Higgs boson at the LHC that, well, first of all, led to the awarding of the Nobel Prize, but perhaps more importantly, put in place the final piece of this puzzle of the Standard Model. Now, as I listened to this story being told in the media, and as I used it, in fact, myself, to explain to people the significance of this discovery, I only gradually began to realize that there was a problem with the story. It really started to hit home to me when my colleagues would come up to me, in some cases a little bit gleefully, and say, well, now that you found the Higgs boson and particle physics is done, what are you going to do with yourself? As you might imagine, this is not my perspective on the situation. In fact, from my point of view, the story is really only just beginning to get interesting. The easiest way to understand that is in comparison with another picture that looks similar to this. Maybe you were thinking about that picture as I've been showing you this one, something called the periodic table. You may be familiar with this from your chemistry classes or other science classes. Now, in contrast with the standard model, even though we have things that are arranged here in nice rows and columns, in contrast to the standard model, I can go through and in terms of three basic ingredients, the proton, the neutron, and the electron, I can explain to you why each of these things is in their place in the periodic table. And with just the rules of quantum mechanics added onto that, I can explain to you such things as why the noble gases on the right-hand side are chemically inert and why the alkali metals are so chemically reactive. In contrast, if I return to the picture of the standard model, I can't answer any questions like that. Why are there three columns, or as we call them, generations of particles? Why is there an increasing pattern of mass? Why is the top quark so much heavier than anything else? Why are the neutrinos so light that we haven't even figured out yet a way to measure their masses? Why are there two types of particles? Why are there four forces? I don't know the answer to any of those questions. And what you might find even more shocking is that if I ask about the universe as a whole, not just what we see in the room around us, but considering the whole universe, what fraction of that is explained by the particles that we have here? The answer is only 5%. The other 95% of the universe is made up of dark matter, which is some type of particle, but we know it's not one of these particles. It's something different. And dark energy, which is even stranger, it seems like it's some kind of property of empty space. If the Higgs boson is really the end of this story, I don't think it's a very satisfying ending. Now, I was explaining these ideas to a group of freshman students that I was teaching, trying to make these points. And for me, this highlights why it's so important for researchers also to teach, because these students, they pointed some things out to me that I hadn't considered. They pointed out that all the questions that are bothering me, they're why questions, not what questions or how questions. And that's easy to understand because the standard model answers all of the what questions and the how questions. But they also pointed out to me that why questions are tricky because there's no guarantee that you'll be able to find an answer. In fact, the answer to a why question may just be it's just that way because. I mean, sure, I don't find it to be very satisfying, but I think it's also fair to say that the universe doesn't really care whether I'm satisfied, right? I mean, it's just the way it is. So this challenged me, and I've been thinking about this ever since that class, and the thoughts that I've had in thinking about this and wrestling with it really have informed the words that I'm saying to you today. So at the beginning of this talk, I asked you to think about what was your favorite story and why. And I would love now to start a conversation where we could talk about our favorite stories and exchange, you know, the reasons. But in the interest of practicality and time, let me just share with you my favorite story. My favorite story is by the Irish author James Joyce. It's called The Dead, and it's the story of a fictional character, Gabriel Conroy, as he's attending his aunt's famous annual holiday party. Now, I could go on forever about why this is my favorite story, but if I had only one sentence to sum it up, I would say it's my favorite story because it's true. Not true in the sense that anything in the story actually happened, but true in the sense that it tells us truths about what it means to be in a family, a member of a family, to fit into society, to be in a relationship with another human being. It's true because it has meaning. It helps us understand the world that we live in. Painters, musicians, writers, and I would argue even scientists, we're all seeking to discover, to create these true stories. Finding and telling and listening to these true stories, it's an innate part of the human experience. It's something that we're driven to do. Finding the Higgs boson tells us that we have the facts. But for me, the questions that remain say that we don't quite yet have the true story. Or if we do, we don't understand the truth that it's trying to tell us. This is a really interesting time in particle physics. All of the most attractive and obvious ideas that we have for extending this story and really wrapping up the questions of the standard model are either being proven wrong or on the verge of being proven wrong by the experiments at the LHC. I tell my graduate students every time they make a plot, what you see there in the data, it could blow the lid off this whole thing and completely change what we think we're doing and what direction we're going in. I don't know if we're going to find the answers to the questions that I have, but I'm driven to keep going because of the possible impact that the answers could have. Think about the impact that Copernicus had when he taught us that it's not the sun and the planets that orbit the Earth, but instead it's the Earth and the other planets that orbit the sun. We went from being at the center of everything to being just a small part of a vast universe. I don't know what truths we might find as we continue to discover the other 95% of the universe, but I am confident that they will be transformative. And I invite you to follow this story with me, perhaps even join in helping to create it and let it change you. Thank you.